Now let me explain you this. I can use both, but I have to use one. Okay, here is this half circle is the number, the day zero. The day zero is when the Pleiades, the sun, and the earth are joined together. And that's the 20th of May. Here in the middle, we have an eclipse, an annular eclipse, a partial eclipse of the sun. And this is going to happen exactly the 20th of May, 2012. And then we have the number 16 in here. 16 days later, after the eclipse, is going to be the transit of Venus in front of the sun. Now we have 4 times 13. 4 times 13 is 52. 52 is the new fire. Every 52 years, the sacred calendar and the solar calendar go to the same day, to the same start. That means that this is related to the new fire, the new eras that they celebrate every 52 years. And also we have here the number 20, and there were 13 months of 20 days in the sulking. All this proves that this is the sulking calendar. And we have these dates, the 20th of May, and we have also the 6th of June. We have 2 weeks. I don't know what it means, but we have to remember. And again, as I said, this is more or less saying it's going to be the return of Quetzalcoatl, of Kukulkan, of the Messiah, something important. I don't know if it's related because both of them are so close together. Both of them appear. And this is the eclipse of May the 20th, 2012. It's going to be seen here, United States and Mexico too. Also in half of the world.
Thank you. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with this photograph. This photograph was supposedly taken from the South Pole Telescope that was designed and built for the monitoring and tracking of Planet X, also called Nibiru. This is the base photo.
Okay, so there's many blogs online, there's many people on YouTube saying that Nibiru is actually on its way, it's coming towards the Earth. So I just want to show you a few anomalies that I found on Google Sky and also Microsoft Worldwide Telescope. So if you come here to Google Earth, first of all, I want to show you a picture. This is a pretty famous picture that came out around January of 2008 from the telescope in the South Pole. So it was reported that Nibiru was first actually seen in 1983, and as a result of that, America, we built a telescope on the South Pole in 2006. So in January of 2008, this image allegedly came from the South Pole telescope. And so this is allegedly Nibiru. Here are some, possibly maybe some moons that are orbiting Nibiru. But what caught everyone's notice was there were some coordinates that were left on the picture on the bottom left-hand corner. And what you see here is 5 hours, 53 minutes, 27 seconds, negative 6, 10 degrees, 58. And so if you plug those coordinates into Google Sky, you'll see something very interesting. So I'll pull up Google. And on Google, if you go to the top toolbar, you'll see this button right here. It's going to take you from the Earth view to the sky view if you have the most updated version. So we're pulling up Google Sky now. And I'm going to take those coordinates, which I have on this this post-it right here. I'm going to copy those. And then we're going to paste those here into Google Sky. I'm going to hit search, and you're going to see something quite interesting. So here we go. It's going to take us in right by Orion's belt. And here we go. It takes us into this blacked-out region on Google Sky. But if you zoom out a little bit, you're going to notice something, that blacked out region is actually just a cropped black rectangle that's blacking out whatever is behind it. So it's kind of odd as that picture claims to have the coordinates to Nibiru, and then you actually try and plug those coordinates into Google Sky, and that area has just been cropped out. It's a big black rectangle. And to further illustrate this, if you go to the bottom of the rectangle, you can zoom in. Maybe I went too far. If you zoom in here, you can see that it's cutting like star. This star right here is just cut right in half. And it has this little information tab right here. You can click on that. Pops up a window, but it gives you no information. Whereas other tabs here on Google Sky, you could click on it and tell you, oh yeah, this is that star and yada, yada, yada. But this area, for some reason, is completely blacked out by Google Sky. So it's interesting. Then if you follow the story of this whole deal on YouTube further, there are other people who actually looked on Microsoft's Worldwide Telescope, and they claim to have found Nibiru on here, possibly. So if we look at starting at the sun, and you plug these coordinates in on Microsoft Worldwide Telescope, 06, first of all, be on the sky mode here in the bottom left-hand corner. Make sure you're on sky. Under distance, make sure you keep it at JA2000. Under RA, 060855. Under DEC, 224721. Plug those in and hit go. It's going to take you away from the sun. It's going to take you now above Orion's belt. Some are claiming that Nibiru has moved, and now it's sitting above Orion's belt. Here's Orion down here, and it takes you into this image, which some are claiming is Nibiru, the brown dwarf star. So if indeed this is Nibiru, that's quite fascinating. That's interesting. We can actually pull up the coordinates from this through this window, and then you can actually plug those coordinates in to Google Sky. and I think you'll be amazed at what you see. So now going back to Google Sky, let's plug these coordinates in and see what we find. So I happen to have those copied and pasted right here. All right. So now we're going to copy and paste those here. And it's 6 hours, 9 minutes, 48 seconds, 22, 27 degrees, 54. And we're going to go from that cropped out black rectangle now to these new coordinates. And if indeed Nibiru has moved, it looks like it's jumped up to the north of Orion. And this is the image that appears. So some are now claiming that these are the same images, not sure why there's a color difference. But these are in fact, people are claiming the same image. And you have, you know, like these anomalies, these stars or whatever they are around it, or moons. And on this object you have a very similar pattern. So if this is Nibiru, those are how you can actually find it on both Google Sky and Microsoft Worldwide Telescope. Check it out.
My friends, I'm just breaking off a minute just to show you that there is two suns in the sky. It's not proof, but Planet X is getting closer. You've got total proof now. Have a look, I always said that once I see proof, then I would act on it. Well, here's your proof that Planet X is there. Two suns, no optical illusion on my lens, I can go and see that. So there you are, folks. Proof now that Planet X is here. We're seeing it here in the UK.
Sleeping somewhere cold, until you Active galaxies require a massive compact energy source of enormous strength to stabilize the orbits of stars contained within them. The engine, which drives the direction of rotation and shape of each galaxy, consists of what astrophysicists refer to as a supermassive black hole located in the direct center. The central black hole located within our galaxy contains an estimated mass of over 1 trillion stars and is believed to be over 2 trillion miles in diameter. Many leading astro and quantum physicists also believe that supermassive black holes spin at an unbelievably high rate due to their overwhelming mass. At this high rate of spin, the black hole's projected gravitational field is no longer spherical, but rather flattens out to form a massive yet extremely thin spinning disk. Our galactic plane can easily be identified by even the untrained eye. As one views the shape and characteristics of our own galaxy, from images provided by the Hubble telescope and projected computer simulations, we can easily see that all matter moves and is formed around this flattened gravitational influence.
This also explains why all galaxies are flat and circular. If you look at our own galaxy, there exists a dark band which shows you where this gravitational plane is located, where galactic dust and mass has been collecting since the birth of the galaxy. This is where we can easily see the location of the galactic plane, which is what modern science refers to as the galactic equinox.
But what does this have to do with humanity's future? In the Milky Way, which is an active galaxy, our solar system cyclically moves above and below this galactic plane. As stars and planetary systems, including our own, approach this galactic plane, the gravitational influence increases, which disturbs the stability of each planet, including Earth. The passage through the densest portion of the gravitational plane is the direct cause of the devastating cycles and pole shifts that we see recorded throughout Earth's history. This cyclic nature of our solar system as we move through the Milky Way is precisely how many ancient civilizations based their calendar systems. The Mayans themselves describe what they refer to as the dark rift, or the galactic plane, in ways eerily similar to those of modern scientists and physicists. The Mayans state that the end of each age, which brings about worldwide devastation, is defined by the world sitting on the dark rift. Even though the Mayans don't clearly present the science behind why the galactic plane causes severe implications upon Earth's stability in modern terminology, it is very clear that we are talking about the same event, an event where the Earth passes through the galactic equinox, the dark rift, or the central plane. It all refers to the cyclic and destructive gravitational influence created by the supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way. Researchers and scientists agree that we are indeed approaching the end of what the Mayans define as the current age. Even though many science groups are still debating the full implications of what passing through the galactic plane will have upon Earth, we have already begun to see the early stages that the increased gravitational influence is having upon our world and other planets in the solar system. As we approach the gravitational plane, we will continue to experience severe weather and ecological effects such as earthquakes, tsunamis, hurricanes, and volcanic activity with increased frequency and intensity. As we penetrate the densest portion of the galactic plane and experience the full gravitational effects, we may witness unprecedented solar flares, unexpected meteor showers, and one or more geographical pole shifts. Subsequently, unexpected celestial objects may pass through the solar system as they too are influenced by the gravitational plane. This may account for the ancient records describing several past worldwide catastrophes accompanied by passing bodies, comets, or what some researchers today refer to as Planet X.
Utilizing the latest in research data, we can speculate that due to the overwhelming rate of spin and the generated gravitational field, the galactic plane or gravitational disk could relatively be paper thin, requiring Earth, with our current speed of movement through the galaxy, only a few years to completely pass through this plane, experiencing the full effect upon Earth's stability. If this data is correct, could this be what the Bible refers to as the 7 years of tribulation, in which the Earth undergoes a series of devastating global catastrophes which result in the death of billions?
Well, one thing is for sure. The ancients endured several worldwide catastrophes that all but erased their civilizations from the face of the Earth. Their clues, structural remains, and records have attempted to warn us and prepare us for the reoccurrence of this cyclic event. Warnings that so far humanity has ignored. Though modern researchers have a general time frame, we are still unable to pinpoint the exact year in which we will begin passing through the galactic plane. So even though the telltale signs are already evident throughout our world, how can it be known for sure when you should be bracing for tomorrow?
Computer simulations utilizing the collection of knowledge we have amassed through decades of galactic models and satellite data tells us that our solar system will definitely begin passing through the galactic plane in the very near future. The most severe effects that will cause worldwide devastation and a pole shift are most likely to occur beginning sometime between the years 2008 and 2015.
Mother, I will sleep knowing that you are both safe, that the fear is over. We have seen the process of life take place. Maybe this is the way it happened on Earth millions of years ago. Maybe it's something completely different. I still don't know really what the monolith is. I think it's many things. An embassy for an intelligence beyond ours. A shape of some kind for her. Something that has no shape. Your children will be born in a world of two suns. They will never know a sky without them. You can tell them that you remember when there was a pitch black sky with no bright star and people feared the night. You can tell them when we were alone, when we couldn't point to the light and say to ourselves, there is life out there. Someday, the children of the new sun will meet the children of the old. I think they will be our friends. You can tell your children of the day when everyone looked up and realized that we were only tenants of this world. We have been given a new lease and a warning from the landlord.